Yes. Okay. Welcome, everybody. My name is Willem Torop. I will be chairing this room this morning. And I'm very happy to announce the first couple of speakers. For you, I will do the announcement in English, by the way, because the speakers will also do the presentation in English. And the first talk will be Oops, We Overhauled the Website by Michael Boelen and Patrick Reine. And you can't have missed that we have a new website for the NLUG at the moment. And it's done properly in the spirit of the NLUG. And I'm very much looking forward to see this talk and learn about how to do this problem. So, I also heard you have 81 slides, so I will not talk any longer and leave you to the slides.
Let's go.
Morning all. Yes, we overhauled the website and we did that with TGV speed, like we will do this presentation, TGV speed. Michael Boelen, co-presenter, Patrick Reine, the other one, going to show you what happens to our website. So, a bit about what we're going to handle, some history, why the redesign, and a lot of technical stuff with migration, new features, and future plans. Who are we? Well, we have a nice new website. Use it, find us, and you can learn everything about us. Eventually, website at nlug.nl also works. Warning, way too many slides. Yes, we have way too many slides. So, questions, if they are long, keep them till the end. If they are short, please raise your hand and we might see it and act on it. Some history. Wow. I was too young to even remember this site and specifically this logo. But one thing that pops up immediately, purple is the color over at least about 30 years by now. For that time, a very decent website. Then, 1998, we had a new logo, which looks like the current one, showing the name and actually what the name was standing for. We have some hot topics on the right corner, menu, and mostly news-like items. It was based on Linux, by the way. Then in 2001, it's based on FreeBSD. Apparently, we switched operating systems. We have a whole lot more menu items, and for the rest of it, still a lot of news-like items. Which brings us to 2006 version. Someone used a rolling pin on our logo. It is stretched all over the place now. It's still FreeBSD used. Apparently, we had a bureau called Interactie that does all the secretarial work for us. And apparently, O'Reilly was involved for the book stuff. Still news, the hot topics, and a large menu. Okay, 2007, still FreeSB. We have a new logo, the logo we all know at the moment. For the rest, still looks the same. Then we go to the site as we know it still about half a year ago. It's Linux-based again, Debian, and completely overhauled by then. We have a menu bar on top, we have a menu bar on the right, textual parts in the middle. It's a bit more structured than it was before. We switch over 15 years back up to the site we are now at. And now you see the site. It's a widescreen, mobile first. Essentially, menu on the top, some news and common information on the site, on the first page. And you click through it. Applause. is allowed. Thank you, thank you, thank you. Why this redesign? Well, the old site was Debian, old version, old Perl stuff, missing all modern things like CSS3, like HTML5. Performance, well, okay. We liked a bit of performance with things like time to first bytes. Social integration, mobile friendly responsiveness, it wasn't there. If you looked at the old site at your phone, it was like, okay, I need extra glasses to read it. So, new features, of course. We want to add new features that will all pass throughout this presentation, like fixing a lot of existing issues we found. And the bonus, well, it gave us the opportunity to give a talk about it. Issues to tackle. The organizational structure. If you looked at the old sites, URL, menu, directory, contents, it was a bit unorganized. Let's say it that way. You will see a lot of examples of that passing through next screens.
You call that organically grown, yes?
I call that hysterically grown. Not historically, but hysterically grown, which is fine, but every now and then you need to weed out all things that are not needed anymore and to restructure it. That's what we've done. There were duplicates. There were errors, both human-based, because looking up stuff manually was hard in some situations, knowing what you were looking for, not able to find it. A lot of errors also technically. If you look at the Google search stuff, which we are using in the background, all lots of HTML errors of all kinds that will be shown later on. It wasn't mobile friendly, as just mentioned. Social media integration, yeah, there was actually almost none. And discoverability, yeah, already actually mentioned part of it. The human factor, finding things, and the machine, the search way, machine searches, it was hard to find. As can be seen by this index stuff, the duplicates are shown. By the way, the numbers, the 15,000, it's including all endlich domains, so also test domains, also FTP domains, and also production domain. We're now bringing that back to mostly endlich production website only, so those numbers will change. But you see all kinds like duplicate stuff, soft 404s, blocked due to access forbidden. Those were the issues of the old sites. And the most nice one, nicely colored green, 0% mobile friendly. I would have expected that to be flashing red. But, well, Google is nice to us. Issues with URL structure and duplicates. You can see that mostly on the three items at the bottom. Abstracts. We have three different naming conventions for abstracts. If you look at events, they are under endlich.nl and under activiteiten/events. So structure, naming conventions, it was, well, in place, but if you have to look after it, you can find it. Social media, if you look at the at the message of FD0, you'll see he is using a link in it, and that's it. If you look at our new site, we are using a link, and it shows up with a nice display, making it a more complete tweet, toot, whatever way you want to present it. Navigation, scattered information, no shortcut to find information, mostly actually managed already navigation, well, there was a menu on top, there was a menu on the right side. It's now all structured in one menu. Scattered information, yeah, what I already mentioned. You look up something, you know that it is there, but how to find it manually. So start searching and maybe you find it. And the migration to Hugo, which made it all a lot better, we think.
We think. Well, let's look into that. So first of all, why did we choose for this specific tool? We got from the board an option to use Nicola, and we tried it out, and we found it to be a very nice tool. But when looking for, especially in the beginning, for looking for a piece of community, and especially if you want to troubleshoot, then the word Nicola is well all over the place, but not for the tool itself. So it was very hard to find things. But even if you find things, the community was very small. So we looked into it and we said, well, are there more open source tools that are also a static generator? And we came with Hugo. What you can see on the GitHub page is that they have a lot of stars. It's not a holy number, but it definitely helps to give an indication on, well, how well maintained is it, how well known is it, and the community around it. The tool itself produces a static output, so it creates the HTML that you then sync to your web server. It's easy to install because it's just one single binary, batteries included, everything is in one place, so no kind of dependencies and all kind of packages you need to install. So it really has a lot of good things. The only small bad thing is there's some kind of learning curve. I see a hand, so that means a short question.
You're sure there are no personal arguments to this?
I got a son with the same name, but no. Besides that, I use it also on my blog, so I also had a little bit of experience with it before. And I must say that that also helps, because when you're building different kind of websites, you learn from each of them, and you can use that knowledge in the other side as well. So Hugo, in a nutshell, it's about templates. It's about the content, which is in our case in Markdown. A lot of YAML here and some JSON there, especially for the data files. Assets, images, icons, those kind of static files. Then even more templates, because you want to template as much as possible. And then in the end, a lot of errors, because Hugo is fairly easy to use, but when you're building things and you made a small mistake in the template, you will get errors. So that's a little bit about Hugo. Because it can be a presentation in itself, we will not do that today. Is there interest for maybe a next time who wants to see that possibly? Okay. Then we leave it here for now. But we will consider submitting a new presentation then. So with the migration, we had two main focuses. One of them is improving the quality and the health of the website itself. So it means from it should be performant. It should be with as less errors as possible. No dead links, more the generic part of what makes a website a good one, besides design and usability. On the other hand, we had difficulties with humans finding our website properly, but also with machines finding our website properly. And I will show a few examples later on. But for example, Google and other web engines, they almost killed us. They gave us almost no traffic simply because they thought, you have a website, but it's not mobile friendly. And sure, we will put you in the index, but we will almost send no traffic to your website. So that was a hard lesson that we learned as well. With discoverability, we also decided that we wanted to make things open. So the content, but also the templates and everything around it is available. So we put that on GitHub. And in fact, also the website of today, or the presentation of today, is already on the website. So if you want to look into this later, then be aware that it's available. What we have done for the migration itself, because we had two parts into one bigger whole, and that was, one is the member only area, so where you subscribed to the events. That was part of the website, so we had to deal with that in the first place. And secondly, we wanted to make sure that when we were going to, use this open heart operation, that we didn't kill off things, because we wanted to make sure that the member-only area kept working, and especially Jan will be very grateful for that. But also that people can still find it easily. So what we have done is we put the new website on the main domain. We created a new virtual host to put up the old website, so that we can keep a bit of a history as well, so if we want to look back. And at the same time, we use this virtual host in the case that you come across a link, for example, in your mailbox or maybe from the search engine. We wanted to prevent any 404 errors. So we use that as a fallback as well. And then the member only area, we put that on a new host name so that we can separate it and have it safely somewhere. And also with the preparation for Jan, maybe in the future, that we can easily replace things. I see a hand.
I know that Leiden is being hosted on the old machine, and the Edmonton.nl is hosted on the new machine.
New machine, yes.
But where is Archief, does that point to the old or to the new machine?
To the new one. So the first two are on the new virtual machine. And this is left on the old machine. So when that's migrated, then we can move forward with the old machine. So what we have done is, especially because Patrick all mentioned it before, duplicates are one of the worst offenses that you can do when it comes to search engines. Because if they see two pages that are similar in text or in style, they can get very confused, and they can send the traffic to an old page because it might have known that from the past and thinking that the newer page that we duplicated, that it may be a copy. So what we wanted to avoid was that the search engines kept indexing the old stuff. So we added a header. So what we did is in Nginx. And we tell the search engine, don't index this, because this is old, please don't. So that helps a lot, and especially with the transition period, so that the search engines the sooner know, okay, we should leave this, and we should focus on the new content. Then we did a little bit of magic to migrate old URLs to the new ones. And if you are familiar with Nginx, you might already know the map function. So what we do is we look at a request, and we replace that, and we get that information from a single file. That file looks like this, and this is just one single line of it. So you see here an old URL style, like Patrick showed. and we replaced that with a new link. So it's a much longer one, but for search engine optimization, it's a much better one, because here there are almost no words that describe what it is about. Sure, abstracts is a word, events is a word, activiteit is a word. But when you want to promote content, you rather want to have real words and real topics. In this case, Bjorn had a talk which is in Dutch and might not have been the most hypey words, but still, this applies to all abstracts and talks, of course. This last statement is very simple. If there is a line in this file that has a match, so the red part, then it will give a redirect, and if not, then it simply does do nothing. So nothing special, but it's a simple trick that that helps a lot. Second thing is using of a proxy, and what we have done here is by default in Nginx you use this typically location slash and then you say well try some files. You look and depending on the type of request, you can request a directory or you can request a file. So we try to find that on the disk itself, but we have added a small thing behind it. And this is less common, but a very good trick or usage as well. What we can do with it is do something else. So if it's not available on the disk, we cannot find it as a directory or as a file, then we say, okay, let's look into this proxy if we can find it. Since this is a lot of text, I will declare each bit in three steps so that we can look into it more what it's doing. So first of all, we have that archive website hostname. That's the one that I showed before. This is our fallback as well. So it's just a normal browsable website, but in the case that a URL is not working and would normally give a 404, then we say, well, let's first look into this and see if we still got it. And if so, we proxy it to that virtual host, and we rewrite things back to our website. So that way we can get the data back from the archive, but still remain on our normal website, so that we don't have to switch you forward and back, and that you get lost in an old website, because we replaced the website with a very good reason. The second part is that we don't want to use any compression, especially with HTTP2 and compression as well. In the backend, that doesn't go very well, and it refuses to rewrite the thing. So we use an common HTTP version, and we disable the compression. And then the last part is the usage of a subfilter. That way, the data that comes back, we can simply rewrite parts of it. So what we have done is we looked in the HTML code, and we found this content table data tag, because in the past we everything created in tables, obviously, but that's fine for now. And what we have done is we say, well, if we find this and we find it once, then we replace this with this whole piece of HTML code. And the result of that is what you see at the bottom. So this way we can clearly say, hey, you found something, an old piece of data, but we want to make sure that you can still, find it or read things. But please note, it's old. It might be outdated. It might be even have full lies by now. So what we have done is show this message. And Well, unfortunately, in the PDF, it's not visible, but this is having some nice blink function, which you can see in the CSS used here. Unfortunately, blink is really deprecated, so we didn't want to use that anymore. So a little bit more about the health and the quality of the website itself. Well, obviously, we wanted to use a static generator like we did actually in the past, because that Perl code created also a static output. We wanted to use assets as small as possible, like images, etc. No JavaScript, JS, when possible, because for most of it nowadays you don't need it. Only the search function, it has some computing power needed, so we used it there as well. And we wanted to make sure that the health and the quality of the website could be as good as possible by testing where possible. So we wanted to use monitoring and testing tools as well. And I will show a few examples. Some of these tools, and they are really focused on performance. Not sure if they sound familiar to you. Someone familiar with it? A few, okay. So these kind of tools, and I will show a few screenshots, but their main focus is displaying how well and how quick a website loads, and especially not just in the amount of bytes that you're pulling in, but also in the time that it takes, but also in the time that it takes to first get the first bits and being able to actually do something on the website, like some kind of interaction. Because if you have to wait, let's say 5 seconds, and the whole time the screen is white, then you think, it's stuck or it doesn't download anything. So it's very important to, when the first few bits come in and you can do something already, like showing at least some kind of outline, that you can start interacting with the website, like scrolling or actually seeing what it's about. So you can see a good example of this is white, and then you see at least some text so that you know I can do something like reading or scrolling. And a few things that are important are this bit, the time to the first byte, the largest contentful paint, the LCP, and the time to interactive. So what it means here is that within less than 1 second, you can actually do something with the website. You can actually scroll down. And 1 second still sounds like, very quick. In this case, it isn't. So maybe the test site was not very close to where our web server is located, because obviously our main audience is located in the Netherlands. So that's a huge benefit. But still, having a website at least being interactive within 1 second is very good. And especially if you test a lot of different kind of sites, you will notice how bad some websites really are. This is from GT Metrics, also a nice website. Here you see that LCP again. It's tested from London. And you see it's much quicker, so it's almost one-fifth of we saw the number just before. It also gives a grade based on the performance and the structure of the website. So including the HTML, but also the assets that it's pulling in. All these things together will give you, give GT Metrics an indication. And if you extract that information, you look into a more detailed level, you can also see why you get not 100% score. As you can see, we went for almost perfection, so we have still a little bit of work to do, but this is not bad. Our friends from Google, They have also a tool, PageSpeed. They also give scores on performance, accessibility, best practices, and search engine optimization. And it depends a little bit on if you're testing for mobile or for the desktop. And I think in this case, it's a desktop test. As you can see, we really aim to make it as good as possible. And that's another interesting thing as well with the website, because some people will say, well, what a boring design. I will come back later on that, on purpose, we kept things as quick and performant as possible at the moment. Another simple tool, Pingdom. They simply also give a grade, but they tell you what the amount of data is pulled in. So that's a first good indicator. But besides that, and obviously the load time and the number of requests, it doesn't say much about how well the website will function. Then we have Google also with the webmaster tools. And one of the issues that we really had was with using our previous website on a mobile, especially if you wanted to read some pages, you really had to scroll to the left and to the right. And that's something what Google also noticed. We didn't have the Google Webmaster Tools before, so directly after when we started with the migration, we added the Google Webmaster Tools, and we looked into some of the details and errors that it gave. And you see here that almost 400 pages, which was, I think, also the complete website with all the data that it found, that it had several issues with it. Text too small to read, so simply it's being scaled down, so it was hard to read, so you had to zoom in and then you had to scroll because it didn't fit anymore. Those kind of things. A viewport, which defines how it should be displayed on a mobile device. If everything is small and packed together, then it says, clickable elements too close together. So you get small text links which are squeezed down, making it very hard with your finger to press the right one. I have small fingers, but still I managed to click on the wrong button as well. So this is a very nice information for, that the search engine gives us this as feedback so that we could improve upon. But as I said, this is from the old website. So after the migration, it gave us a score, but not about the new one yet. So that's what we're seeing as well. So we started here with importing the website, with connecting the Google Webmaster Tools to our website. Well, and in this case, it's not green, but really the red is bad. And you see, for a long while, it stays red, and then slowly it finds pages that are becoming green, and that had to do with the migration itself. This is the same data, but then a while later, and as you can see now, it's all good. So the pages that it finds, it finds them as mobile friendly. You see some shifts in pages, so sometimes a lot of new pages are being added. But then later on, the search engine does the indexing of those pages, and it says, you have a nice page here, but there's almost no text on it, and it drops it from the index again. So that's why you see the decrease in numbers. But it doesn't mean that those pages are not mobile friendly, because they can still be usable for us as humans. So regarding the content, what Patrick already said, we had a lot of scattered information all over the place, even that we, when we were part of the board, that we knew that some content was there on the website, but we simply could not find it. So we had to click all over the place. So that's what was something that we really tried to fix, making one menu with the most important areas, but also making sure that content could be moved together. So sometimes it was simply copying one page and updating the content so that it was up to date again. And sometimes it was getting multiple pages and merging them into one page. For example, Jan helped me also with the members information. It was also scattered over different pages and the benefits. And so we said, well, let's pack it all together at one place. I see 10 minutes, so we quickly go. we had a lot of links that went dead over time, and that's what's called link rot. It happens, and it's something that we are aware of, so that we are already testing for that as well. Right now, not fully automated yet, so we do it once in a while. But the idea is with the website now being on GitHub that we also can automate a few things, like workflows, that if it, let's say, it finds a new link that's not working, that it automatically creates an issue so that we can say, okay, we have to look at that page and this particular link. As mentioned, the webmaster tools, important, it's not the same as analytics, because I know a lot of people here, they don't like Google for that reason. We don't like that either, so we don't do analytics. We only use the webmaster tools because that can give us an impression on what a website looks from the, well, from the outside. And I must say the Google Webmaster Tools, but also that from Bing and Yandex are fairly clear. And they provide a good detail or a good level of detail while still being usable and find issues quickly. Well, Bing and Google are probably known to the most of us. Yandex maybe less. It's a Russian search engine, and although we have nothing to do with Russia, and oh, I shouldn't say that. In this case, it's still usable as a tool because it looks at different kind of things than that Bing does, and it also looks at different things that Google does. So combining those gives us the best of all. This is an example of Bing. You can do a site scan, it's named. And what it does is quickly go through to the website. You can limit it, but in this case we said, well, just check the whole website. So it's about those 400 pages. And it gives you directly errors when you get most likely 401 or 403 or 404. And also a little bit of SEO stuff. In this case, you see that we have a warning, but sometimes, like us, we have a long title, so the title of the page will be long as well, and yeah, we accept that. This is also from Bing. So you see, again, the SEO suggestions, but also if there are specific markup types, and I will look into that a little bit later as well. So this is a useful tool for those that maintain or administrate websites, besides obviously the Google Webmaster Tools. We want to improve the pages itself, so that's also website health and quality. So we want to make sure that we didn't use tables for showing a layout, but really for data. We wanted to use all the modern HTML tags available, and keep the styling out of it, because we had a lot of styling inside the HTML code itself. So we want to make sure that we use CSS for the styling and the HTML for building up the page itself. For performance, we decided to use an inline style tag. Normally, you create one CSS file and you import it from all the pages and say, well, this is the file you should use. But when building up a page, and that's the graph you've seen a little bit before this, the time to interaction may take a while, because first it needs to download the HTML file, then the assets, and then the style sheet itself. So what we decided was, because we have a very small bit of CSS, that we do it in line so that it has it right away. So it's one request and it has the HTML and the CSS in one. And we decided to strip as much white space as possible. I'm going to skip a few bits because of the time itself. The presentation is online, as said, and you can already see it today. An interesting one besides a sitemap file is IndexNow. It's a new, well, a newer technology used by especially Bing and Yandex and some others that tagged along. Google is not using it yet. And it's a sort of a sitemap file to tell the search engines what kind of pages you have within your website, but in this case, focused on the recent changes. So you tell it, hey, I've changed today this particular page. Please index it as soon as possible so that it can be used as soon as possible. So very useful for new pages, for new URLs, and for those that have a content update. And one of the examples, this is from Bing. You can see we started adding the speakers today, the speakers of the event today. And when we did that, those got submitted and added. I see that Bart, for example, is in the room. So you got your own URL. the other part is schema. Also a topic on itself, because it contains a lot. This is like metadata about what's on a website. Because on a website you can have normal content, normal text, but you can also discuss persons like Bart, for example, or like Jan, for example. And by using schema, you can tell something, hey, what I'm telling here, this is about a particular person, or this is our logo, or this is our breadcrumb items that we have on the top of the website. Schema output looks a little bit like this, and this is a parsed version of it. So you can say, well, we are an organization, we have a Twitter account, we should add Mastodon, obviously. We have a Wikidata entry, we have a logo, we have contact points, like our board and like our bureau. This defines, this gives the web or the search engines more information about the data that's not always visible. Well, we got a lot of errors, and we'll skip that. We got when things are fixed, Google will tell you as well. So this is the Search Console, the Webmaster Tools. So when you fix things, it will tell you as well. Validator tool with the links as well, because if you want to test this out, then this might help. We wanted to open up things, so the content, the templates, everything is available as well, as of about 5-6 months ago. Sure. Yeah, we wanted to share. I got 1 minute. This one says 2 minutes. we wanted to showcase more the people that are active for our organization. So we created pages for the commissions. We created for the individuals pages so that we can showcase and make it easier to find as well. So regarding the time,
30 seconds.
Yeah. So there's a whole lot more.
We got a search engine, very important. So if you find want to find something in the future, we got a search engine, so please use that. Is this broken?
It's fuzzy.
It might be JavaScript, because you need to enable that.
Yeah, but I searched from two browsers, even from Chrome. Yeah.
Hmm. We'll check.
Yeah, I said something here about feedback. But please give us feedback.
Yeah, that.
You made it.
We got a, yeah.
Basically, everything is in GitHub. Yeah. So
do we have time for one question?
Yes, but you need to repeat it.
For the recording.
Yes, for the recording.
Does the website still work on the terminal?
Does the website still work on the terminal? That's something we didn't test. But I guess we can. I guess we can use links or some kind of tool for that. Yeah, it's a homework for us. So.
Thank you, Michael, Patrick. All the questions to the hallway.